Welcome back to Crystal Clear. I'm Ushrik Fox, and something that's still blowing my mind is that Steven Universe is now set 2 years in the future, giving us a time skip with a lot of really neat details. And now that we're officially just in this waiting period for what comes next, alongside the fact that I've watched the movie over and over and over and over again by this point, I thought it would be neat to lay down everything we know about this time skip thus far and just give a brief little crash course. What's changed about the world and these characters? Who has a new look? Who strangely doesn't? And who else is joining Steven in the Net Gang? Well, without further ado, let's dive in. So of course, let's start with our titular character, Steven Universe, who has jumped from the age of 14 to 16. Steven is noticeably taller, putting on a few inches, sporting a blue star shirt with a pink varsity jacket. Of course, the biggest attraction about Steven's new look is his neck, and he's noticeably stronger than he was before, almost being able to completely lift up Spinel's injector, summoning multiple shields and bubbles with ease, and showcasing evolutions of a few abilities. Accompanying Steven, we have Connie Maheshwaran, who's now 15 and a half years old, also taller in height. Her hair has grown to her length, where it's stylized in a fashion that's similar to in between her last two styles. Connie's still rocking the sword Bismuth gifted her in Change Your Mind, and recently ventured into space camp, although the specifics of such are still unknown. In my breakdown, I mentioned that maybe Connie went to actual space, and to give some clarification, I'm aware space camp is a normal thing that actually happens without going into space, but I sort of made a leap in logic that Steven Universe, being a fictional series in a world with more advanced technology, had a space camp that was actually anchored in space. But after saying it aloud, I definitely see where I made an obvious error. While we don't have a great idea how this could tie into the overarching story, I do think it's interesting that they included a line of dialogue where Steven wanted Connie to inform all of her campmates that space used to be really dangerous, but now everything's great. Because let's just say, hypothetically, while at space camp, Connie casually divulged some information to those who hold authority and power. How far could word travel to those who don't really vibe well with the gems? And what consequences would that have on the series? But moving on from our main two teens, let's have a focus on Beach City, starting with Steven's house. As we've already referenced before, Steven's house, after being damaged in the Battle of Blue Diamond, has been rebuilt to be two stories tall, with a brand new diamond base attached that seems to double as a greenhouse, where Lion and Connie hang out in. This new diamond base also contains a galaxy orb, whereas previously the only galaxy orb was far out in the middle of the ocean, destroyed by the crystal gems at the end of the Gem War in order to ensure that Homeworld could never return. At least, not directly. Now, after establishing peace, Steven has a direct link to Homeworld just a few footsteps outside of his room, as the second story of the house contains a balcony and walkway to the diamond base, and the only thing that stands in the walkway's way between Steven's room is a sliding screen door. Not gonna lie, the new design of Steven's house finally makes it one of those fictional houses I would love to live in. Whereas before it was cool because it was attached to a temple, this new house to me puts it amongst the likes of the Kids Next Door treehouse, Foster's Home for Imaginary Friends, Fenton Works, and whatever the name for Hmong, Truffle, and Chowder's house is. All they had to do was add a second story and a base. But yes, Steven finally has his own room. Although we covered most of this in our movie breakdown, he's ditched the GameCube for a PS2, and all throughout both Steven's room and the house itself are Easter eggs and callbacks from all throughout the series, such as the photograph of Greg and Rose, Vidalia's painting of Steven and Garnet from pool hopping, the remains of Rose Quartz's sword after being crushed by Blue Diamond, Steven's t-shirt cannon from Shirt Club, and more. Considering the house has expanded, we can assume there's now a space to include Peridot, Lapis, and Bismuth. The crystal gems are now a complete unit, a truly expanded family. So it makes sense, especially after the events of Change Your Mind, that the seven of them are under the same roof. But now let's move over to the Boardies. Yes, that's what they're referred to as internally, not the Townies. A few inhabitants of Beat City have altered in appearance in various ways. The most drastic by far is Petey, who also has put on a few inches, sporting what appears to be a blazer and white dress shirt with khakis and Crocs? Really? Crocs? However, this blazer in particular doesn't quite fit just yet, which I believe is to put on an image of entrepreneurship while not truly being a full-blown adult just yet. Petey has decent business ideas, but he has some more growing to do in order to fully realize them. Notice that his hot toot tot truck is nowhere in sight, as he's returned to work at Beat City Wok Fries. So we can assume that the hot toot tot truck ultimately failed, as come on, they're tater tots. They're not that much crazier and different from fries. It wouldn't surprise me if they just added tater tots on the menu. But moving on, staying in the Fryman family, Ronaldo has a new shirt, ditching the burgundy with flames for burgundy with an orange dragon. Which honestly does make him a bit more weebish, but it fits. Moving on to the townies as a whole, Vidalia has an entire new wardrobe, ditching her former green dress shirt, white tee, blue overalls and red slippers for a red sleeveless shirt, blue scarf, high-waisted pants, and black shoes, which still exuberates, as the cool kids call, big art ho energy. Sadie Killer and the Suspects have new wardrobes that don't appear until the rock show. Sadie's hair is now blonde on top, with green hair fading in through the middle and to the bottom. Remember, she previously appeared with completely green hair at the end of Change Your Mind, so now she appears to be meeting herself halfway. Sour Cream wears an orange headband, blue vest, and white t-shirt with orange tips. Jenny has a long-sleeve light red shirt, a yellow scarf, white tee, and jeans, while Buck is just living the complete rockstar dream. Lars seems to also have his own new casual outfit, ditching his previous outfits for a puffy brown jacket and black shirt, wearing solely the black shirt during the rock show, but not to be confused with the black shirt with a skull that he began wearing circa season 4. Lars has also returned to the Big Donut, now contributing directly to the menu with his own creations, donning another new outfit, which is simply just a light blue shirt with a striped apron on top. There's no word on if Lars and the off-colors still have the sun incinerator, or where the off-colors are residing, which could potentially be within Little Homeworld. Although before we fully dive into that, I do want to acknowledge that Onion has not aged at all. Either he's a lot younger than we initially believe, or the Crooniverse simply did this because they find it funny, which it kind of is. But of course, you guys know me. I like to read deep into this and suspect that Onion's youth could be a result of him potentially being half alien. Another hybrid, just like Steven, for a different alien race. Nah, probably not though. So yes, Little Homeworld, a small society that houses gems should they choose to live on Earth instead of their proper planet of origin. As of the movie, Little Homeworld appears to be 83.7% complete. Bismuth, Peridot, and Lapis leading construction, with assistance from Amethyst, a few other court soldiers, the Heaven and Earth Beetles, Snowflake Obsidian, Watermelon Tourmaline, and more. It wouldn't surprise me if Snowflake Obsidian, Biggs Jasper, and the gem many believe to be Crazy Lace are all assisting in the construction of Little Homeworld because they are close friends with Bismuth, who has been name-dropping them since her debut episode. Little Homeworld's architecture does resemble the home planet that it's imitating, with its shapes and colors. However, it's constructed out of Earth-based material. Bismuth seems to have set up shop in Little Homeworld, constructing a new forge, which may also mean she could be residing here more so than at the temple, but we'll just have to wait and see. Now, something that I found amusing is that although we don't see the inside of these houses, how gems will live in Little Homeworld, during the little ending song when Lars and Sadie walk up to Steven, if you look at the top left corner, there's a rock inside of one of the houses. I'm not quite sure why, other than the fact that gems are polymorphic sentient rocks, but I find it to be a very nice visual gag. Now, the impact of Little Homeworld and Peridot and Lapis' contributions is that Little Homeworld has been stated to be on the countryside, with its warp pad being installed in a very particular place, as the area once housed the barn, Peridot and Lapis' former residence, before Lapis uprooted the location, fleeing to the moon, and later dropping the barn, destroying it on Blue Diamond. But on that note, how is Homeworld itself doing? Well, we can actually deduce quite a bit from its small appearances. It seems as if Steven was able to help Homeworld actually save his colonies from completely dying out, as the process of both colonization and creating gems can kill a planet, and of course its resources. There also appears to be much more freedom and independence amongst gems, as it appears they can travel wherever they want and mingle with whomever they want. This is most noticeable with the center of Homeworld in the middle of the four diamond ships. Whereas before gems would stand in a color-coded arrangement in line with their four courts, they're now scattered about, not really following any sort of order. Now, as deduced from the diamonds themselves, the colonies have been liberated. The armies have been disbanded, so Homeworld really has no defense force in the case of an invasion or, let's say, uprising. Gems are once more free. The relationships between what was once high-ranking gems and quote-unquote lower life forms have also improved, even if, judging by White Diamond and Steven's conversation, there's still a ways to go. Yet, if there's one major issue with this new Homeworld, it appears as if there's no real order. The gems are free, but then what? Things can still fall into chaos and disarray, now so more than ever. The diamonds still have to be leaders, they still have to communicate, and there probably should be some, while much less severe, reasonable rules to keep things organized. However, there's one thing that I absolutely love about Era 3. It's that Blue Pearl and Yellow Pearl appear to have their own television show, complete with their own logo. Entertainment is now a part of Homeworld. But aside from broadcasting messages to the universe, what else do they do? Blue Pearl likes to draw. Does she have a Bob Ross type show? Yellow Pearl likes to model. Does she host Homeworld's Next Top Model? Like, what's going on here? All I know is I'm excited to explore more of Homeworld, especially with this new society and rules. And just overall, looking at Beach City, Little Homeworld, and Main Homeworld, Steve Universe is ripe for plenty of new stories, whether they're story-driven or just fun one-off episodic adventures. But as always, these are just my thoughts, and I want to hear yours. What do you think? What is your favorite addition to the time skip? Would there be anything you would change, take away, add? Let us know your thoughts in the comments below, or tweet your thoughts at RoundTableVids. And for more of my own thoughts, you can find me at AustralFox. We're also on Instagram. Help Roundtable grow by either becoming a member of this channel or supporting us over at Patreon. Link in the description. If you enjoyed this video, please throw a like and subscribe to the Roundtable for more great cartoon content. Thank you for watching, and I hope you have an awesome day. AustralFox, signing out.